Hey everyone, welcome back for another guide as we dive deeper into the world of Hellbreath Olympia. This time we'll be discussing every aspect of PvP within Hellbreath. This has been a topic a lot of people have been asking for, and it's taken me a while because it deserves to be looked at in great detail. I will say, before we go further, I highly recommend watching my beginner guide first in order to understand the basics, since this video will often assume you already know everything discussed in that guide. Alright, let's dive into it. From the outside looking in, and this goes for most people who didn't play Hellbreath 20 years ago, the game doesn't necessarily look like it could possibly be packed with all of the intense, often intricate levels of skill that go into being successful in PvP. Don't get me wrong, there are times where the monotony of chasing after someone with little hope of catching them can be grueling, but that is exactly where understanding the game and the options you have at your disposal in each situation can make all the difference. That's where I hope this guide will really shine, by helping you to get maybe just a bit better, to be a better teammate, and most importantly, to have more fun. The basic aspects of PvP have not changed from the original days of Hellbreath, and that's because the PvP is what helps it stand out against other games within the genre. There are tons of third-person MMOs that fail to capture the simple essence of what makes Hellbreath's PvP so fun and addicting. Seeing the enemy kill notification explode over someone's head as you annihilate them, the burst of text as you receive the kill count notification and your victim's name in the log, the fight or flight moment when you hear the enemy's invisible footsteps, or the pre-gank adrenaline rush as you're about to assassinate some unsuspecting hunters. These elements really get the blood flowing, and they're just the tip of the iceberg. Hellbreath's gameplay seems simple. Move around the grid, warriors try to get close and swing, mages try to keep their distance and shoot. Now add in your magic protection buff, your regen timer, your set swapping, your positioning, timing of enemies' magic protection, enemy creatures swarming, elite creatures slowing and paralyzing, enemy captains teleporting in allies for backup, and yeah, it gets intense quick, and it can be difficult to understand what's going on at first. As a veteran, it's fairly easy to spot the new players in the fight by recognizing that their armor isn't vortexed or they're out of position. There's several tells. So let's start by talking about what you really need to know in order to better survive out there. Your build is your baseline. It's who you are in the game, so choose wisely. The variety of talent combinations can be daunting, especially for beginners who don't know what builds are better than others. Well, the good news is that the game is at a point where most builds are well balanced, providing more opportunity than ever to try almost any combination of talents without negative consequence. Unfortunately, it's still common for new players to become frustrated, especially after leveling their first character to 140, and they start to wonder if another build might be more fun. We've all been there, so don't rush out to buy coins for talent tickets unless you want to. Instead, it's highly recommended that you accept this as normal and invest some time into leveling a few characters to 140 before you dive into rebirths. This way, you can be certain you've chosen the build you want to invest your time into. With that being said, let's assume you've found your preferred build, and now you're ready to start splashing the recent list with your killing sprees. But first, you need some gear. I realize I said I wasn't going to go into any great detail about things I've discussed in my beginner guides, but armor attributes are super important, so let's make sure we all understand what we're dealing with so we can set ourselves up for success. Your armor sets are essential to your survival in Hellbreath. Whether you're a mage or warrior, most players carry 3 to 4 unique sets of armor that they swap between depending on the situation. First, let's take a look at each attribute and discuss them individually. Defense ratio and physical absorption are defensive attributes that apply to physical attacks. Your total DR is stacked against your opponent's physical hit ratio to determine whether their attack will land or not. The higher your DR, the better the chance you can dodge physical attacks. DR is a global attribute, which means an attack is weighed against your total DR every time, not just against the individual piece of armor the attack strikes. PA, on the other hand, determines how much damage your armor will absorb before reaching your health pool. The higher your PA, the more damage you absorb, and the less damage you take. All armor has an inherent amount of PA. The heavier the piece of armor, the more base PA it has. You can obtain armor that gives additional PA, as well as special items like an M-Shield wand or a PA sapphire that fits into your angel slot to help boost your global PA. So, when an enemy attacks you, the game rolls a die to determine which piece of armor the attack will strike. Let's assume you're wearing a plate mail with a bonus attribute to physical absorption, and the rest of your armor has bonus DR attributes. If your attacker lands a hit on your plate mail, the damage received will be reduced based on the total PA percent of your plate. If it hits any other piece of armor besides your plate mail, the attack will hit for the full damage. DR and PA are important endgame pieces of armor, and are therefore somewhat expensive to build or acquire with a high enough percent to make a significant difference while wearing them. That doesn't mean they aren't useful at lower attribute levels, but you won't see the same return as you will once you've invested a lot into building them up. I realize that sounds like basic logic, but I want to make sure you aren't expecting to buy some basic pieces and be instantly unkillable. Magic resistance and magic absorption follow in a similar vein to DR and PA, but apply only to magical attacks. Your total MR is stacked against your opponent's magical hit ratio to determine whether their attack will land or not. The higher your MR, the better the chance you can dodge magical attacks. MR is a global attribute, which means an attack is weighed against your total MR every time. MR is super important for dodging spells like Paralyze, Mass Illusion Movement, and damaging attacks while you're not amped. In the case of magic absorption, it differs from physical absorption in the sense that it's applied globally, meaning magical attacks do not strike specific pieces of armor. Therefore, your total MA percent from all armor pieces is factored in every time you're attacked with magic. Magic absorption is capped at 84% and can be boosted by special items like an Emerald Ring or an MA gem in your Angel slot. Magic absorption can be a powerful tool, even with relatively low stat armor, as long as you have multiple pieces. The closer you get to the 84% cap, the better the results. Just beware, because your MA set will not protect you from crowd control spells like Paralyze, Mass Illusion Movement, and Slows. That's where MR is the better option. HP and MP sets are pretty straightforward. Armor sets with HP regen attributes will regenerate your health pool, and an MP set will regen your mana pool. The higher the total percent of your set, the better your regens will be. Keep in mind that your regens are based on your in-game timer. This is set initially when you log in. You can adjust your regen timer at the shop using the rest function. Most people set their timers at 0, since HP regens every 15 seconds and MP regens every 20 seconds. Therefore, if you set your time at 0, you'll have a much easier time remembering to swap your sets at the appropriate time to hit key regens. Critical increase chance refers to the odds of instantly regenerating a critical. A crit regen can proc upon being struck by an enemy with either physical or magical damage. This is a cumulative stat across all armor pieces that's capped at 20% and applied globally, meaning it's not dependent on the armor piece being struck directly. Individual armor pieces can have a CIC percent ranging from 3 to 7. The higher the percent, the more valuable the piece, since having fewer pieces with CIC allows you to have armor pieces with other stats like mana conversion, which we'll discuss next. It's never too early to start thinking about min-maxing your sets, but having at least one set with CIC, as a warrior in particular, is very important. While we're on the topic of critical regeneration, we should note that crits regen naturally, one every 20 seconds from the last critical used. Aside from the short sword talent, which can proc crit regen simply by attacking while holding a short sword, the only other ways are by being struck by mobs or to inflict damage upon yourself. The easiest way to achieve this is by using a blood weapon and simply attacking mobs, using the return damage as an additional chance to proc a crit regen. You'll often see people attacking mobs with a blood rapier or axe off to the side of a fight, and you'd be wise to employ this method as well. The other important first stat, particularly for warriors, is mana conversion. Mana conversion returns mana to you upon being struck by either physical or magical damage. This is a cumulative stat across all armor pieces that maxes at 30% and is applied globally, meaning it's not dependent on the MCON armor piece being struck directly. Most people typically use 1 to 2 pieces of MCON in any set, most often using 2 pieces around 15% each to reach the 30% cap. Mana conversion is useful in any set, but most important in sets you'll typically be wearing while taking damage, like your DR and PA, or your MR or MA. Endurance can be an overlooked stat by a lot of people, but it has an important role, particularly for endgame players min-maxing their sets. Endurance is most useful on your DR and PA pieces, as you'll likely be absorbing the majority of attacks in those sets, typically leading them to strip or break first. No one wants to have to leave a fight to repair, and while this is not a super common issue, it can happen, especially while fighting Hammer Warriors or if you enjoy 1v1 duels. Let's look at the most common sets warriors should typically carry. DR and PA are somewhat interchangeable depending on your build and preference. As a short sword or fencer, you'd be better off with a PA plate and legs and can possibly even forego DR. But as a heavy weapon warrior, you'll likely prefer a full DR set, as they don't have as large of a health pool to risk getting stunlocked by multiple attackers. Choosing between MR and MA is personal preference, but I typically recommend starting with MA, as it's much more helpful for new warriors since it can be effective even at low levels as long as you have a full set. A 20-coin MA set and PFM can make you an instant nuisance to any mage. MR, on the other hand, can be very good in late-game builds, particularly for people with a Medusa necklace. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. Some endgame builds mix MR into their MA set once they get a few pieces highly enchanted, so you might one day consider that as well. For now though, go with a 20-coin MA set and you won't regret it. Warriors should always carry a full HP set, including a shield to guarantee maximum regens. An HP set with an average stat of 70 or above on each piece will serve you just fine. Remember, it's a good idea to try and build sets that provide a combination of crit increase chance and mana conversion. Now let's take a look at the typical sets mages should carry. As a mage, an MP set should be the first set you focus on building. A mage is useless without MP, and you won't be regenerating much without a full set. For beginners, seek to acquire or build armor with experience as a first stat, so you can use it during your rebirths as well. Mages should try to avoid sitting in their MP set during battle. Instead, you should mainly wear your defensive set and only swap into your MP or HP set when it's time to regen. When it comes to DR or PA as a mage, you should typically stick to one or the other. Most mage builds have little to no dexterity, which makes them easy to hit with physical attacks. Therefore, using PA may seem good since you'll be hit for less damage, but you'll really be risking getting stunlocked. DR, on the other hand, is much more common and honestly the better option for a mage, but it may feel somewhat useless until it's at a very high level. Choosing MR or MA as a mage really comes down to personal preference. Some mages run full MA sets with great success, but, as we've discussed, this leaves you vulnerable to crowd control when off-amp. MR on a mage can be very strong because it's combined with the MR from all your magic attributes within your stat build. This means that a mage's MR is inherently quite high, so adding more MR on top of it is quite the advantage, particularly against low magic builds like warriors. However, MR can be a bit underwhelming until it's about 77 plus per piece and vortexed. For many mages, this set will be the last one they focus on. Mages typically do not have much vitality, and as a new mage without many rebirths, I'm willing to bet you're only rocking about 60 to 80 vit max. A good HP set is going to be essential in order to avoid having to regularly chug all your pots or constantly stop to slowly heal yourself up with great heal. Wow, okay, that was a lot of really important but admittedly very boring information. Let's move on to something more fun, weapons and special items. I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt and assume you know which weapons apply to each talent. However, new players often want something strong out of the gate and can't wrap their head around how they're going to pump damage when they can't afford any of the nicely enchanted weapons on the market. Well, let me give you some good news. There's plenty. Many of the rare weapons in the game are actually very common. Not only because the server has been active for about 6 years, but because it's designed to keep you engaged. Let's take a look at some of the rare weapon options you can pick up for relatively cheap. Or, if you're lucky, maybe another player will be nice enough to give you one for free. Please note that some items listed are simply for reference, and while not cheap, are still relatively inexpensive compared to other top-end rares in the game. PvP is the core of Hellbreath's gameplay. Everything revolves around the potential for combat to break out at any moment. While hunting is another key component, PvP is interwoven throughout all aspects of the game. Fights can occur anywhere, anytime, And while there may seem to be a few safe areas you can retreat to, even those aren't always truly safe. The most common place you are basically guaranteed to find a fight is Middleland, the land between two cities, teeming with monsters to kill and the gateway to great hunting maps like Icebound and Tower of Hell. The fight here is nearly constant and can range from small-scale group battles to massive engagements. The biggest fights usually occur when the Elementalist spawns, with potential rewards similar only to Abaddon himself. While Middleland is the great arena, hunting maps like Promised Land, Icebound, Dungeon Level 4, and Tower of Hell 3 are prime spots to gank unsuspecting hunters. The fights that can break out in these maps are epic in their own right. And then, there are the cities themselves, with their back maps like Garden, Death Valley, and Silent Wood, that are no longer safe on raid days, giving enemy players plenty of time to infiltrate and cause mayhem. PvP engagements, regardless of size, revolve around control. Control can be gained by catching or putting your opponent in a vulnerable position. Obviously, vulnerability is relative. You're vulnerable when you're outnumbered, outgeared, outskilled, but most often, vulnerability in Hellbreath is related to magic protection. If a player is not protected by PFM or AMP, then they are vulnerable to every type of magic. If a player does not have any type of magic protection, then they are called off, FF, or no time. This lets your team know that an enemy player is vulnerable to magic, and that they should focus trying to slow them, paralyze them, and ultimately execute them. Situationally, however, it is typically best to first try and place a weaker buff onto the enemy player, disallowing them from being able to gain magic protection. This is most often done by casting Defense Shield onto the enemy that you know is not amped. This will keep them vulnerable to crowd control for the next 60 seconds. If we examine a mass fight in Middleland between two teams of 10 to 15 or more, one can quickly recognize a pattern to the movement. The fight flows back and forth, with one side pressing and one side retreating, then suddenly reversing roles in the opposite direction. The key factor behind these swings in momentum is a team's average magic protection timer. Across a large team, there will be a wide range of magic protection buffs, coming off and going back on across any 60-second period. Sometimes, those times start to clump together, and suddenly, a significant portion of your team is coming off their magic protection at the same time, causing your team to need to retreat in order to give your mages time and space to reapply amps. The way to take advantage of these situations is to identify the time specific players receive their amp and call it out to your team. This way, 60 seconds later, you know who to focus in the lead up to their time coming off, putting the enemy team in their most vulnerable state, pushing them backward as you try to take advantage of this brief window of opportunity. Once a player is off, it's time to employ crowd control measures like Defense Shield, Paralyze, Slows, Mass Illusion Movement, or maybe just try to nuke them off the map. There are several types of crowd control spells you can employ, but the most common way to restrict a player's movement is with the spell Paralyze. Once an enemy is paralyzed, they cannot move for a significant amount of time. The only way to break out of Paralyze is magic damage. The most common ways to break out of Paralyze are to cast a spell like Energy Bolt or Fire Strike onto yourself, or if you or an ally casts Firewall or Fire Field directly below your feet. Enemy players will try to counter this by casting Spike Field under the target first, disallowing any magic spell to take its place for the duration. Once an enemy is paralyzed, they are susceptible to all kinds of attacks. Mages should do their best to allow warriors to beat the target down to as low as possible before shooting, or even avoid shooting at all if possible. This is because an ill-timed magic attack on a paralyzed target can release them and allow them to recover to safety. Warriors should typically wait for a target to be paralyzed before unloading their criticals into them. This is because critical attacks provide additional HR and a 100% damage bonus. We'll discuss the best ways to attack situationally in a moment. Other important crowd control spells that can be used on vulnerable targets include Mass Illusion Movement, freezing spells like Mass Ice Strike and Blizzard, stun and burn spells like Hellfire, stamina reducing spells like Earth Shockwave and Stamina Drain, and inhibition magic casting. Most of these spells can affect their targets even when they're PFM'd, but will be useless against a target that is amped. But then, there's always cancellation to remove those protections in an instant. Other forms of crowd control can come from warriors using items like an Ice Elemental Sword or Medusa Sword activations. This will slow or paralyze an enemy that is struck. These activations are best combined with Zulima weapon activations to quickly cut through an enemy team during a well-coordinated attack. As I mentioned a moment ago, let's talk about how to use physical attacks in different situations. If you want to make the most of your opportunities, it's best to attack properly depending on the situation. Yes, I am saying that there are wrong ways to use physical attacks in certain situations. Let's dive in. Let's start with a common, pure warrior build like Longsword Axe, and our imaginary player is using a blood sword because it's cheap and provides an 80 HR bonus to go along with our HR 60 necklace. These talents synergize nicely as the longsword talent provides strong damage, extra HR, above average critical attack range, and a bonus to dash speed. Pair all of that with Axe's passive bonuses to crush chance and crush damage, and I'm betting you like what you're hearing. You are going to have a fair amount of success with this build as a new player. You're not a tank, but you're not a glass cannon either. You're an average foot soldier that can land strikes a reliable amount of the time with decent attack power on the front lines. The key to this build is in your positioning and mobility. The bonus dash speed you get from the longsword talent will be one of your greatest assets. While chasing an enemy player, if you pay attention to your pathing and distance, you can consistently land devastating blows in quick succession. Keep in mind, you not only receive a damage bonus while dashing, but by attacking an enemy from behind, you greatly reduce their DR and PA, allowing you to pump some real damage. Once you land a few dashes, there's a good chance your target will be low on HP. That's when you finish them off with a spine-breaking critical, putting them down for good. Everything I just explained, particularly in regards to pathing, focusing on dashing, and prioritizing attacking from behind whenever possible, go for all warrior builds, regardless of the weapon you're using. Therefore, I'm not going to provide examples for each build type because the concept is the same across the board. I will say, though, that you should always keep your attack range limit in mind, especially with critical attacks while using weapons like hammers, and especially axes and short swords, as you need to be much closer to your target to land them. With that being said, let's briefly discuss how and when to use your criticals. Too often, we see warriors blasting out all of their criticals in quick succession on any player that comes within range. This is a complete waste, since these players will likely regen in a few seconds, rendering your attack pointless and causing you to need to wait for those precious criticals to regenerate. You need to pick your moments, like when you and a few teammates are all attacking simultaneously, stun-locking the enemy and bursting them down, or when an enemy is paralyzed, or when you're sneaking up under cover of invisibility preparing to gank someone. In such a case that you're executing an invisible ambush, it's smart to position a warrior on either side of the target to avoid flying the enemy away from you upon attack. This will allow you to fire off more attacks in a short amount of time. Seeing as I just highlighted an important note on positioning, let's talk about it briefly. Regardless of your build, warrior or mage, positioning is everything. Being even slightly out of position can result in your death or allow an enemy to escape in an otherwise certain death situation. Be mindful of the flow of battle, the positioning of enemy players and even creatures, as allowing a beholder or frost to freeze you in Tower of Hell 3 or Icebound can turn an entire fight. Positioning is one of the fundamentals that, once learned, can elevate you from someone just participating in the fight into a game changer. For example, if you and your team are chasing an enemy player that is a few spaces ahead of you, do not blast criticals into their back unless you are absolutely certain they can be killed with that attack. Because if you don't kill them, it only flies them further forward, away from you and your team, giving them more breathing room to manage their escape. Instead, you should ask for a haste from your team. Use that speed boost to get out ahead of your target and then blast criticals into them, flying them back towards your team. Some maps have tight corridors that make it difficult for multiple players to maneuver through at the same time. Once you have a good understanding of the map, you can use this knowledge to block off passages, thwarting an enemy's retreat and potentially trapping them in the process. Some players get creative by summoning creatures, holding them in place with slash hold, and making them invisible, creating a barrier across a passage too wide for one or two people to block on their own. Lastly, one of the best ways to use positioning to control an enemy's movement is by boxing them. This means surrounding them with players on all sides, or trapping them against a wall using players to close the box. This restricts their movement and can all but guarantee their death so long as someone doesn't break the box. Part of the learning curve in Hellbreath as a warrior is having the courage to stand and fight toe-to-toe. Fear of death can sometimes cause you to turn your back from a fight, inevitably leading you to a more cowardly death. The moral here is don't be afraid to die and lose a Zem. People might talk some trash, but so what? Next time, you might come out on top, and then you can decide if you want to return the banter. Here are a few additional tips for warriors. As a warrior, you have two jobs. The first is to pressure the enemy team, especially their mages, around the time you know their team will be going off amp. Make it as difficult as possible for them to reapply amp to their team. The second is to support and defend your mages. I know it's hard to do two jobs at once, but you can't only focus on attacking the enemy team. There will be times that you need to help your mages by giving them a haste or an invis when they're under heavy pressure. Don't get tunnel vision. Be a good teammate. When chasing, one warrior should stay on the target to keep applying occasional damage, preferably poison when possible. Keep in mind that an enemy can recall after 15 seconds without receiving damage. The other warriors, if they have haste, should try to haste their mages to the front of the pack, since mages cast faster and have higher magical HR to land the paralyze or apply another crowd control effect. If your entire team just runs after an enemy without anyone hasting their teammates forward, simple physics dictates that you will never catch up, and the enemy will likely make it to safe. So, don't be greedy. Haste your teammates when appropriate. Mages have their high and low points to be sure, but overall they can be very rewarding in their playstyle. The dichotomy of a mage is thus, blow someone up or be blown up. This is especially true for newer mages who have yet to complete some rebirths and build up their sets. However, that doesn't mean you can't be a useful teammate. Just keep in mind what we've talked about so far, particularly regarding positioning. Keep near the back of your team, supporting where you can and looking for an opportunity to land a defense shield, a paralyze, or a kill shot. If you find yourself out of position, you might be melted before you even realize it. You can help yourself by carrying a lot of red pots and invisibility pots. You also don't have to play a high burst damage build as your first character. Playing a lower damage, high support build like Lightning Marion can provide you a lot of extra stats and in return, survivability. The difference between playing as a new mage and a geared mage compared to a new and geared warrior is vast. Geared mages can operate in spaces that new mages typically wouldn't survive in for more than 3 seconds. Even geared mages can be blown up very quickly if they aren't careful. The point being, if you see mages in certain positions and taking certain risks, don't automatically assume you can play in the same style, unless you're prepared to die and don't mind running back to the fight. In that case, play the backline stalker, reporting enemy amp times, or be a greedy, stealthy assassin to your heart's content. Next, let's talk a bit about one of the most powerful spells in the game, Cancellation. Cancellation wands are fairly common in Olympia, and typically cost about 20 coins for a wand with a full 200 charges. Once those 200 charges run out, the wand is somewhat useless because it can't be enchanted to increase stats in the same way other types of charge wands can. Just something to note. Now there are good and bad times to use Cancel. If you're impatient and cast Cancel at the wrong time, you can even put your team at a disadvantage. One of the most effective ways to use Cancel is by setting a trap. You can do this by communicating to your team that you're going to pre-cast Cancel, indicating to them that they should invis you and prepare follow-up spells like Defense Shield and Paralyze. Whenever possible, you should call out your target beforehand, but typically your team will know to watch out for your cast and then react to it. You can be as stingy or freewheeling with your cancels as you'd like. Don't be afraid of someone poking fun at you for missing or wasting a cancel. Just get them back with the next one. Cancel can even be used defensively in certain situations. If you or your teammate are in a tough spot, defense shielded and vulnerable, you can always use cancel to remove that DS from yourself or your teammate and quickly protect them with a fresh amp. As a warrior, you should stay aware of the potential for a cancel trap and keep your Sword of Heaven at the ready. With a little bit of practice and awareness, you can survive a cancel trap with a quick swap and activation. Since we just touched on some survival and support tactics, we should also talk about how incredibly important it is to support your team. If you have guildmates that you play with regularly, especially a warrior or two, try to focus on mainly supporting them by keeping track of their times, amping them, berserking them, hasting them, and reloading their criticals if you have the Marion talent. These are all much more important than mindlessly chasing a group waiting for an enemy's amp to run out. Help your warriors to keep the pressure on, and you'll all be rewarded with more opportunities for EKs. One of the best tools at your disposal, particularly for survival, are invisibility potions. These pots are relatively cheap at about 3 coins for 100 pots, and easy to make once you level your alchemy to 50%. I don't want to run off topic, but here's a quick graphic you can refer to showing what you need to easily level up your alchemy. Invis pots work instantly to make you invisible upon double-clicking them in your bag. However, they do have a 15-second cooldown timer before you can use another one. A common tactic when running away from a group of enemies is to eat an invis pot and then walk in a line away from where they last saw you, leaving them to detect at where they think you are and possibly missing, giving you a chance to then run away or recall. If you stay aware of your surroundings, you can use the enemy creatures to your advantage. It can be very difficult for an enemy to keep up when they're getting slowed and stunned by a creature's attacks as they try to chase you or cast detect. This is particularly useful in maps like Icebound and Tower of Hell 3, where the mobs will freeze your pursuers and give you a better chance to escape. On the flip side, if you're chasing someone down and they employ this tactic, your team should be on top of using haste to keep you all in the chase. Next, let's talk about thinking a few steps ahead in certain scenarios. Over time, you will learn to read a situation and think about what you're going to do next before it happens. Here are a couple of examples. As a fight plays out, consider preloading the next spell you think you'll need so you can quick cast it from the F4 hotkey. If you know an enemy is about to go off amp, you can have defense shield ready on F4 and your spellbook already open to circle 4, ready to cast paralyze right after. Next, let's consider you're chasing someone towards a safe zone and no one has applied damage in a while. Throw down a spike field that the enemy must run over. This will activate their 15-second damage timer and give you a chance to ice storm the safe zone before they can recall. On that note, whenever you have an enemy trapped in safe, always prioritize ice storm over cloud kill. Ice storm is far stronger than cloud kill. If the enemy is DS'd or only PFM'd, have a fire mage keep 3 hellfire stacks on them at all times to keep consistent maximum burn damage on them. They will die eventually. This next one can be really important. If you think someone is on the map and you want to track them down, use summon creature and the command /hold followed by /target and the enemy's name. And if that player is on the map, the creature will start to walk in their direction. If the creature doesn't move, then the player is not on the map. To wrap up this guide, here are a few extra quick tips that deserve mention. To better hear enemy footsteps, play with the music off and sound on. Learn to identify the sound of players walking versus other creatures. Some creatures sound just like players, and this can't be helped, like beholders and dark elves. When using Ice Storm on a safe zone, pay attention to how you lay them down to cover the maximum surface area and thereby maximizing damage over time. If you spread them too haphazardly, it will be much harder to guarantee the kill. When chasing an invisible player by yourself, and you know they're off magic protection, but there isn't time to detect and get off a paralyze, try just shooting the paralyze by following the pathing of their footsteps. You never know, you might land a gem. Rainy weather in the game can work in your favor as it gives you some cover when running while invisible. Even better, though, is if you pay close attention, you can easily recognize when a player is running nearby from the pattern in the droplets. Surprise an enemy with a devastating counterattack when they think they're moving undercover. Don't discount the utility of Detect Invisibility scrolls, especially as a warrior. So long as you haven't taken damage in the last 20 seconds, you can counter an enemy's invis pot with these scrolls and give yourself a better chance to secure the kill. Keep an eye on poison damage ticks on your enemies. If you see a PD warrior focusing on a target and that enemy starts ticking low blue numbers, then they are very close to dying. Poison damage is based on the percent of health the target has remaining, so the more health they have, the higher the damage. The lower the health, the lower the damage. That makes this a very reliable indicator of how much health the enemy has left. It's good habit when casting critically important spells, especially against targets that you know are high in MR, to equip an HR wand and HR necklace. To take it a step further, try to remember to wear your hero set as well for the bonus HR it provides. All the extra HR from these items may be the difference between a hit and a resist. When casting, it's wise to be aware of the direction you're facing. If you show the enemy your back, you're giving them bonus HR, and you're more than likely to be interrupted. By facing them before casting, you give yourself a much better chance of casting successfully. On a similar note, whether you're a mage or warrior, if you find yourself under pressure and need all the help you can get to cast a spell or two successfully, it's wise not only to face your attacker, but also put your back to a wall or something immovable so that you can't be flown backward or be interrupted. Meditate is a spell granted by the Holy Talent and can be a game changer. Not only can you give yourself a mana boost when needed, but you can keep your warriors, who are always mana starved, at full mana, ready to support you when you need it most. Last but not least, get a Sword of Heaven and don't forget to use it. They cost 5 coins and are one of the most overpowered items for their value in the game. Remember, if you keep the sword equipped while activated, you will remain immune to cancellation for its duration. Taking it off should be a calculated risk because you can bet someone will be looking to cancel you as soon as you do. Alright guys, we've touched on a ton of important topics in this video, and I'm sure there's still stuff I didn't get to. For now, take this information and use it to get better, but most importantly, enjoy the game. Please remember to like and subscribe, share my guides and channel on your guild discords, and comment below to let me know what other topics I should make a guide about in the future. See you next time.